I don't know about you, but when I'm listening to worship songs, I listen for little phrases and try to figure out where the writer of the song picked up that phrase in the Bible. And there was a great one there. Even in your suffering, you saw the other side. That comes right from the book of Hebrews, which we're currently studying, chapter 12, where it says that Jesus, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame. For the joy set before him, even in your suffering, you saw the other side. He went through it because he knew what that would accomplish. The book of Hebrews is just incredible. It's very complex, very complex. If you've been reading it this week, chapters 5 to 10, probably the most difficult part of the whole New Testament, which is why there's no less than 15 pages of notes in your commentary this week. I'm not gonna cover all the difficult portions. We're gonna hit the kind of the big picture, but just know that that commentary is there. And this section, when you get it, when you get the big picture, sometimes you can kind of miss the forest for the trees, but when you rise above it and see the big theme of this section and then look at the details, it's really a fascinating and rich, rich portion of scripture. But I can kind of explain it this way. If someone were to ask me why I am a Christian, why I follow this worldview. In fact, I remember one time somebody did, a relative asked me, why do you feel compelled to be a Christian? You know, I could talk about the intellectual satisfaction that this worldview gives to me. It answers the big questions for me in the most satisfying way. Intellectually, I see where I came from and why I'm here and where things are headed. I have a worldview that doesn't just give me an intelligent designer, but it actually tells me who that intelligent designer is and kind of how life works. The intellectual side is satisfying to me. And, you know, I did my PhD in New Testament, so I got into kind of all the critical theories of New Testament studies and all that. And just to understand that at the highest level of scholarship, the leading scholars around the world see the credibility of the New Testament documents and the Old Testament documents. They see the historical reliability. They see why archaeologists now use the Bible to figure out where to start digging, because it is just a very reliable, trustworthy historical record. When I look at the intellectual side, Jesus, historical Jesus, the fact that no serious scholar today doubts the fact that he lived and there was a historical Jesus, I look at the evidence for the resurrection and the lack of evidence for the other alternative theories. All that to say, my mind is satisfied when I look at Christianity, and I am a skeptic, I am a thinker, so that part's big to me. But beyond that, if they said, well, what else besides that, you know, it satisfies your head? I'd say, you know, when you buy a car, you get an owner's manual, or when you buy a new phone, you get an owner's manual, and the owner's manual tells you how to make it work most effectively. I'd say when I look at the Bible as an owner's manual, it actually provides to me a way to make life work, where the commandments of God, the moral will of God in the Bible, the way I should love, the way I should live, the way I should relate with people, the way I should forgive and be merciful. I look at the Beatitudes that Jesus gave, which are the Beatitudes, the attitudes that should character us by being merciful, poor in spirit, by hungering and thirsting for righteousness and being peacemakers and all that. I look at the stories of Jesus, the Good Samaritan or the prodigal son, and I say, you know, that whole roadmap for life, that whole owner's manual that teaches me how to live, it works. It really works. And that's one of my main appeals to people who are on different sides of a lot of moral issues for me in terms of how to live with life or sexuality or whatever. I don't argue the right or wrong thing. Well, this is right and this wrong. I argue the good, not so good line where God says in the book of Deuteronomy, these words I give to you are for your life. They're for your good. Jesus said, I came that you might have life and might have it abundantly. And so I'm satisfied with the owner's manual that helps me know how life works. But if I really came down to it and I could only give a person one reason that I am a Christian, it would have to do with what this section of Hebrews talks about. We have a God who, instead of remaining distant and kind of just sitting on a throne somewhere and evaluating us, we have a God who decided to enter in, a God who came to be with us, which is why we titled this whole journey through the Bible, God with us, Emmanuel. We have a God who has decided to enter in and to share with us, to participate with us, to suffer with us, to be tempted with us, to feel with us, to literally put on human clothing, to put on human flesh and blood, and to come into our world and be with us, and then to invite us to him on the basis of what he does for us, not on the basis of our performance for him. We have a God who is, to put it in the words of Hebrews, a faithful and gracious and merciful high priest. A high priest. A unique high priest. The high priest in ancient Israel was the person who stood between God and humanity, the ultimate priest, not one of the Levites, but the high priest from the family line of Aaron, the first high priest, Moses' brother. And this was the person who was the person in Israel who mediated between a holy God and sinful people. This was the person, the only person that could go into the most holy place in the tabernacle once a year on the Day of Atonement. He's the only person that could go in there with animal sacrifices, with blood, to make atonement for the sins of the nation. A very important person, probably the most respected religious individual in ancient Israel. And Jesus has come as our high priest. This section tells us that he has come as our supreme and greater high priest. He has come to mediate a new deal with God. He ministers in a better tabernacle, and he's offered a more perfect sacrifice. So this writer is going to really talk about the priestly work of Christ, and why would these audience members he's writing to want to back away from that into something that's safe. He's writing to Hebrews, who are Jewish Christians, but in a time of persecution, they're pulling back to go into something that is safe. Judaism at that time was a legal religion. It was protected, but Christianity was illegal. And so because of the persecution, they're going back to something safe. But his argument is, why would you go back to something that is safe but inferior to what you have been given? Why would you go back to something that is a shadow of the reality? Now you have the reality. Why would you go back to the copy, to that prefiguring? Why would you go back to the preview when you have the whole deal? And his argument is you have something so much better. The word better occurs 13 times in this book. Better, better. Why would I stay as a Christian? Because there's nothing better. There is nothing to compare with Christianity. And his argument starts with Jesus being a better high priest. Here's how he begins this in chapter 4, verse 14. He says, therefore, since we have a great high priest, not just a high priest, but a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to our confession of faith in him. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have a high priest who's been tempted in all things just as we are, yet without sin. In other words, every category of temptation you experience, every category of testing or trial, he has been there. We don't have a high priest who can't feel with us. We have a high priest who gets us at every level. And so he doesn't sit on his throne and point his finger and say, what are you doing? Why are you going through that? He's saying, come, because I've been through that. I get it. And it says, therefore, let us approach the throne of grace. It's a throne of grace, not a throne of judgment. It's a throne on which a merciful high priest sits on a throne of grace. That's why I'm a Christian. My God sits on a throne of grace as a merciful high priest who's been through everything I've been through and invites me to come at any time. Let's draw near to the throne of grace with confidence, not fear, not doubt. Why? So we may receive mercy and find grace for help in time of need. I have a God who says, come on, I'll help you through that. I'll give you grace and mercy in your time of need, not judgment and condemnation. This is why I'm a Christian, because my God, a high priest, came into this world, became like us, experienced everything I'll experience so that he can sympathize with me. Then he not only experienced it, but he paid for it all, atoned for it all. Now he sits on a throne of grace in heaven and says, come on, Bob, anytime about anything, you can come to me. It's a God of love. It's a God of invitation, not condemnation. And I can come with confidence because of who he is, not because of who I am. I don't come with confidence to the throne of grace because, oh, I've got it together. I can go to the throne of grace today. No, I go with confidence because I don't have it together, but the one who sits on a throne is a merciful high priest. Here's what it says about him. Here's how he became that merciful high priest. In the days of his humanity, let that sink in. Our God became a human being. Find me another world religion where the God says, I will become one of you. I will actually add to my deity true flesh and blood humanity. I will do that. I will become the God man so I can relate with you. In the days of his humanity, he offered up prayers and pleas with loud crying and tears. You ever cry to God? You ever cry out to God in agony? You ever cry out to God in hurt and pain and in wondering? Well, guess what? He became human and cried out to God with loud crying and tears. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he sweat drops of blood praying, Father, if possible, let this cup of your wrath, this cup of my suffering, let it pass from me. And yet then he brings that humanity in subjection to the divine and says, yet not my will, but thine be done. But he had to learn all of that. It says that. He had loud crying and tears to the one who was able to save him or keep him from that death. And he was heard because of his devout behavior. Although he was the Son of God, he learned obedience from the things which he suffered. What God comes into the world and learns obedience so that he can relate with his people? What God does that? Why am I a Christian? Because my God comes into the world, becomes one of me, and learns to obey so that he can understand, as I'm trying to learn to obey, what that's like. Now, he did it better than I do. He did it perfectly. But he learned obedience from the things he suffered. And having been perfected, it says, he wasn't perfected in his essential being. He was perfected in his role as the great high priest. He had to be perfected or made complete in that role. And having been perfected, he became, for me, the source of eternal salvation for all those who obey him, being designated by God as a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. I won't go into Melchizedek. There's two chapters on it and about 10 pages in your notes on that. It's very deep, but it's very cool stuff. But the point here is that this high priest came into our world and he suffered. He learned obedience. He gets it. He gets what you're going through. The greatest thing about Christianity is whenever I'm going through something and I'm kind of, you know, maybe frustrated or experiencing things, I'm wondering, like, God, where are you? Like, why aren't you answering this prayer? Why aren't you showing up? Or this God says, I have been there. I've experienced the exact same thing. So even if he doesn't give me the answer as to why he's doing what he's doing, he whispers to me, I know exactly what you're feeling because I have been there. And that just, it settles me to know that God weeps with us. He feels with us because he actually went through it. And then it kind of ends this section, chapter 7. It says, it was fitting for us to have such a high priest, not just a high priest, but such a high priest. And then his attributes, holy, innocent high priest, undefiled high priest, separated from sinners high priest, exalted above the heavens. And he has no daily need like the old high priest to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people, because he did this once for all time when he offered up himself. This high priest not only comes into the world, puts on humanity to sympathize with me, to learn obedience, but then he offers himself as the sacrifice, not for his sins because he didn't have any, but for mine. Who does that? Show me another religion where the God comes into the world at all, but one who comes in to put on humanity and feel with us and sympathize with us and then to die for us. That's why I'm a Christian, because it's all about a God who gives heroic sacrifice growing out of his love. That's what Christianity is about. And that is compelling to me. That is super compelling to me. He is a holy, innocent, separated from sinners, exalted high priest. He doesn't have to daily offer sacrifice. He offered up himself once for all. For the law, the Old Testament appoints men as high priests who are weak, but the word of the oath, which came after the law, appoints a son who's been made perfect forever. God had to perfect his son in the role of being a high priest, and he did that by him becoming one of us. That's who you have. That's who you relate with every day. A sympathetic, merciful high priest who says, come, don't be afraid. Come with confidence. Not because of who you are, but because of who I am. I love that. No matter how I've failed, no matter how I've fallen, no matter what I'm feeling, he gets it. And he says, come. That's compelling to me, to have somebody on the other end of this deal that actually empathizes with me, sympathizes with me, doesn't condemn me, doesn't push me away. I love that about Jesus, and I love that about God. Now, he is a better high priest, but he also ministers a better covenant, because priests in the Old Testament were mediators of a covenant relationship. A covenant relationship is a contract between God and humanity. And there are two major contracts between God and humanity, the Old Covenant, or the Old Testament, and the New Covenant, the New Testament. Those are the two big deals God made with humanity. And so now he compares the two for a whole chapter and a half. But at the conclusion of it, he quotes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 33, where God says to the nation Israel, days are coming when I'm going to make a new deal with you. And the writer quotes that passage. And here it is. It's in Hebrews chapter 8, but it's a quote from the Old Testament. This is the covenant, God says, which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I'm going to put my laws in their minds. I'm going to write my laws on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. And they will not have to teach each one his fellow citizen and each one his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they will all know me, from the least to the greatest. And I will be merciful toward their wrongdoings, and their sins I will no longer remember. A new covenant God promised through Jeremiah. When Israel was in Babylonian captivity, God came and said, I'm going to make a new deal with you someday. And here's the deal. Instead of the law being written on tablets of stone, I'm going to write the law on tablets of hearts. Instead of it being you trying to obey and conform to an external code, I'm going to write the code inside. I'm going to take the code and I'm going to put it in you. I was talking to somebody yesterday who's in medicine. I was trying to understand the different vaccines and stuff like that, you know. I said, what's the difference between, you know, the RNA ones and the Johnson ones? I said, well, the RNA ones, they inject instructions into your body to tell your body how to develop the antibodies. I'm like, how do they write those instructions? Like, do they have a computer that puts it like in a little molecule? Like, is it code or what? He says, well, it's, you know, it's chemical reactions, and there's only four of them, and it writes the chemical reactions in a certain way, and it puts instructions into you how to fight the virus. And the instructions are so accurate, that's why the vaccine, thank you, why it's so effective, because the instructions are so accurate. Wow, that's genius. God says, I'm going to put the instructions inside you. I'm going to inject your heart with my laws so that from the inside out, you'll start to conform to me. It won't be outside in religion, it'll be inside out. And that, again, is something God comes along and says, not only will I come into the world, become one of you, suffer for you, die for you, but then I will go back to heaven and send my spirit, the third person of the Trinity, and I will live in you, and we'll work this out together. What God does that? What God do you know in the history of religions that says, I will make your heart my temple after I've come into the world to feel what you feel, and then given myself to pay the whole penalty, I'll forgive you completely, put it on my account, and then when you say yes, I'll enter in, and from the inside out, I'll change you to be more like me. What a deal. What a deal. Why am I a Christian? Well, just that. I mean, no, there is no religion in the world that does it this way, this new covenant, this better covenant. It's an inside-out deal. That takes the pressure off. That's why it says in Galatians 5, that we need to walk in step with the Spirit, because the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. It's the fruit of the Spirit, not the fruit of Bob trying to obey some law that says be those, but it's the fruit of the Spirit. So the last verse in Galatians 5, if we live by the Spirit, which we do, let us keep in step with the Spirit. So you know what my assignment is? Just keep in step with the Spirit. Keep listening to the Spirit. Keep letting the Spirit of God use the Word of God to change the person of God, and when I sin, confess it. When he's grieved, acknowledge it. I have a person living inside of me. That's, go tell me some other world religion that does this. And by the way, you couldn't make this up. Nobody could make this up. Nobody could just come up with this. Nobody would think this up. It is divine from start to finish. He's a better high priest. He has a better covenant for us. and he serves in a better tabernacle. Get this, it says in chapter 9, when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that had come, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made by hands, not a tabernacle of this creation, and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood, he entered the holy place once for all time, having obtained eternal redemption. He entered through a greater, better tabernacle. He entered into the true tabernacle, not some earthly one. And he explains it in chapter 9. He says, Christ did not enter a holy place made by hands, a mere copy of the true one, but he entered into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. And this writer makes this argument all the way through the book that the Old Testament system was a shadow or a picture of the reality. So the high priest was a picture of the great high priest who would come. The tabernacle, that tent that Moses made, was a copy of the throne room of heaven. The high priest entering in, offering blood sacrifice, was a picture or portrait of the ultimate sacrifice that God would give. The broken laws in that Ark of the Covenant inside the holy place, that was a picture of the sinfulness of humanity, all of sin and fall short of the glory of God. The fact that there was a mercy seat on top of that box on which the high priest would sprinkle blood once a year when he could go into that holy place, he'd sprinkle blood. That was a picture of how there needed to be an atoning sacrifice between humanity's broken law and God's holy standards. It was all a picture, you see? And the veil that stood between the priest and the people and the Holy of Holies, there was a thick curtain. Nobody could go in. That had to do with the barrier between God and humanity. And when Christ died on the cross, you know the story in the Gospels, there was an earthquake, and that veil in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. That was a picture that the way into the holy place had been opened up now through Jesus Christ and his sacrifice. This writer's trying to say, look, these things you're going to retreat back to, that was all just the shadow. You've got the reality. That was the preview. You've got the whole movie now. Why retreat back into the lesser? Because it's safe? Yeah, maybe it's safe for a little while. And by the way, Nero turned on the Jews as well. This persecution was happening to Christians. It's about 66, 67 AD when Paul and Peter and others were killed. But about 70 AD, the Romans turned on the Jews. And though they had fled back, some of them, into the security of a legal religion, the Romans came in and absolutely desecrated and destroyed Jerusalem. Masada, they retreated to Masada, and they had that last great battle. It didn't last for long. They had retreated into something that was safe for a little while. And in the process, they had abdicated something that was so far greater, so superior. He's a greater high priest, mediating a greater covenant in a better tabernacle. And then, this is the best of all, he offered a better sacrifice. And get this, this sort of brings it all together. The better sacrifice. Here's what he says in chapter 10, this writer. He says, the law, the Old Testament, since it only has a shadow of the good things to come and not the actual substance or form of those things, it can never, by the same sacrifices which they offer continually every year, make those who approach perfect. Those sacrifices just couldn't do it. It couldn't make us right with God. Otherwise, he says, would they not have ceased to be offered? Because the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have had consciousness of sins. In other words, they would have known their sins are forgiven, that it has been paid in full. They would have known that, and they wouldn't have had to go back. But as it is, they had to go back. And here it is, it says, but in those sacrifices, there's a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. What he's saying is that all of those billions and billions of lambs and goats and bulls that were sacrificed in the Old Testament, not one of them ever took away one sin, because it's impossible for that to happen. They were all a picture. They were all pointing forward to the Lamb of God who would come eventually and take away sins. They were symbolic. Kind of like when we take communion, we are taking a symbol that looks back to the cross. It causes us to remember the cross. Well, when they were offering those sacrifices by faith, doing God's thing, bringing their unblemished lamb, why did it have to be unblemished? Because the lamb that God would send would be unblemished. Why did it have to be their very best from their flock? Because God would send his very best. You see, all of it was a picture, but for them, it anticipated the cross of Christ. And this writer is saying there is no sacrifice ever been given by humanity that's ever taken away a single sin except for one. And that one sacrifice has taken away all sin for all time. Here's what he says next. By this will we have been sanctified or purified or cleansed through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all time, all time. One sacrifice for all time. He says it again. Every priest stands daily ministering and offering time after time the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But he, having offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God. Why did he sit down? Because the work was finished. He didn't have to offer any more sacrifice. When he said on the cross, it is finished. He didn't say, I am finished or you are finished. He said literally in Greek, it is finished. And he put it in the perfect tense in Greek, which means once and for all, the work I was sent to do is completely finished. He paid this sacrifice for sins for all time. And he sat down waiting from that time onward until his enemies be made a footstool for his feet. For by one offering, he's perfected for all time those who are cleansed through him. This is the beauty of Christianity. The writer is saying, you know, in the Old Testament, billions upon billions of lambs were offered. From the time of Moses, 1440 BC, to the time of Jesus, you calculate it out. That's 1,440 years. Just on the annual day of Passover alone, there were 200,000 lambs sacrificed in Israel because there was one lamb for every group of 10. In the days of Jesus, there were 2 million pilgrims in Jerusalem for Passover. That is 200,000 lambs on one day. Just multiply 200,000 for 1,440 years, but then add in all of the daily sacrifices and the annual Day of Atonement and all the other festivals and the Levitical offerings. I calculated it once. It comes up to something like 5 billion plus lambs that were sacrificed. Did you know that when Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane, he had to walk up the Kidron Valley and he had to walk up this path to get there? And on that path, they have discovered a channel that ran out from the temple to take the blood of the sacrifices, 200,000 lambs. That's a lot of blood flowing. And it flew right down that channel past where he walked. The blood of hundreds of thousands of lambs, and not one of them took away a single sin. It all anticipated the one. And so the way I was taught this as a new Christian, it just blew my mind. Jesus Christ stands at the center of history. History is his story. He promised that he would come starting in Genesis 3:15. When Adam and Eve sinned, he said, oh, you know what? Someday the male offspring of the woman will come and crush the serpent on the head. And it was a prophecy, the very first prophecy that a savior would come. And he was prophesying of himself coming someday to crush that serpent. But right there in the garden, he clothed Adam and Eve with animal skins before they left, which means he offered a sacrifice. And so they knew that there would have to be a sacrifice, a death, to pay for sins. But they knew that animal that was killed didn't pay for any sins, so it had to be a symbol. Cain and Abel offered offerings. Why was Abel's offering better than Cain's? Well, because it was a true picture, offered with a true heart. You go through the Old Testament, it was all a picture. So Jesus Christ stands at the center of history. History is his story. And when he died on the cross, he put out his arms like this. And the way somebody explained it to me, they drew a timeline and they put Christ in the middle and they put a cross and then a shadow flowing from the cross in both directions over all of human history. All sins that have ever been committed were only paid for by one sacrifice from Adam until the very last person that lives before Jesus returns. All of those sins were paid for by one sacrifice, the cross of Christ. The cross throws a long shadow in both directions. And they said to me, and Bob, by the way, when Jesus died on the cross, how many of your sins were still in the future? And I thought about that, and I thought, well, I hadn't even been born yet, so all my sins were in the future. So he said, so if Christ died here and all your sins were in the future, now you stand here, what does that mean about your sins that are still in the future? Because, you know, there's this tendency to say, well, Jesus died for my sins and I've accepted him, so he died for all the sins in the past. But when you keep on sinning and you keep on failing, You're like, oh, does he still forgive me? And he kept reminding me, how many of your sins were future when Jesus died? And I said, all of them. That's what this passage is saying. He died not just for my sins that are in my past, which were future when he died, but my sins which are still future today. In other words, the sins I'm going to commit tomorrow, he's got it. He doesn't have to die again. He offered one sacrifice for sins for all time. Who does that? What God does that? Show me a world religion that does that. Show me a religion where a God is this merciful, this loving, this, I'll take the bullet myself. I'll put a cross at the gate to hell so nobody has to go there. It's all on me. All you have to do is say yes. You see, there's nothing else I could go to. And this writer is saying, where else are you going to go? You're going to go back to the old system in some temple with a giant curtain and a high priest who's got to offer sacrifices, and you got to keep going to your flock to get another lamb and another lamb and another lamb? I mean, you're gonna go back to that because it's safe? So inferior. And so I'm going to read you again the passage we started with, because this whole section from chapter 4, verse 14 to the end of chapter 10, it's bookended by these two exhortations to draw near to this God, not pull away from him, but draw near. And so the whole argument is summarized. You've got this great high priest, this great covenant, this great tabernacle, this great sacrifice. Therefore, draw near to him. Don't pull away. So here it is back in chapter 4 where we started. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who's passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let's hold firmly to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who can't sympathize with our weaknesses. We have one who's been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us draw near. Let us draw near to the throne of grace with confidence, so we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Let us draw near, the writer says. I remember finding that in Greek in seminary. They're called hortatory subjunctives, where the writer puts it in the third person but says, let us, the let us passages. They're all throughout Hebrews. There's like a dozen of let us, where he puts himself in the group and says, come on, let us do this together. Let us draw near. And here's how he ends this entire section. Therefore, brothers and sisters, chapter 10, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is, through his flesh. Since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God. There it is, the hortatory subjunctive. Come on, let's go. Let's draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith. You can draw near with full assurance, not because of who you are. The only reason you're going to that throne is because of who you are. You're messed up. You need a merciful high priest. The only reason you're going is because of who you are. And in spite of that, you go with full assurance of faith because of who he is and what he's done. Full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. We've been cleansed once and for all by the blood of Christ. Let us hold firmly to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let's consider how to encourage one another in love and good deeds, not abandoning our meeting together as is the habit of some people, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. This book is super complicated, but when you get kind of in a plane and fly over the whole forest and you just see what it's about the superiority of Christ. Don't run away from him in your trials, your testing, your failures, your doubts, whatever. Run to him because he gets it. He understands and he loves you. The reason I'm a Christian, besides the intellect and the owner's manual thing, the love of God stands behind this religion. The love of God is the essence of it all, and it's the love of God that is so unexplainable. This is why Paul prayed at the end of the book of Ephesians chapter 3. He says, I pray that God would grant you power so that you might comprehend with all the believers what is the height, depth, length, and breadth of the love of God that surpasses knowledge. He prays that they would know the love of God that's unknowable. It's so deep. It's so unfathomable. And when you get that love, when you understand that, then your Christianity is on the right track. Until you let the love of God completely wash over you, something will be amiss in your Christianity. It says in 1 John, there is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear. The fear involves punishment, it says, and the one who fears has not been perfected in love. And he goes on to say, it's not that we love God. He loved us and sent his son to be the satisfaction for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, then we can love one another. You see, until the love of God roots itself deeply in you and washes over you and gives you that assurance, there's things that block our feeling of the love of God. And if you've got that, you know, you had a really difficult upbringing, a really difficult father, something has blocked your feeling of the love of God. You'll never make adequate progress in your Christianity until the love of God becomes the foundation. And when that becomes the foundation, then you can approach him with confidence any day about anything, because you know where you stand. You know you are messed up, but you know your great high priest gets it and says, come on, come on. I'll give you mercy and grace again today if you draw near to me. And that's why we're doing communion today, because that sort of embodies the whole thing. Communion, when you're holding those communion elements, you're like the Old Testament saints that were holding their lamb. When you handed off your lamb to the priest, you're handing off the symbol. When you hold the bread and the cup, you're holding the symbol of this whole idea of the God who became human and died on a cross to become your merciful and faithful high priest, and you're holding those very symbols in your hand. You're holding the reason we're Christians, because God became one of us and cares about us and says, come on, I love you. I get you. I'll help you. I'll indwell you. I'll forgive you again and again and again and again. And you're faithless, but I am faithful. So keep coming to me. Let us draw near. Let us draw near. That's what we're going to do. First, I want to pray, and then I want the band to come, and I want them to sing a song over you. And as you prepare your heart for communion, I just want you to let the words of this song, it's so beautiful. It takes this entire message and puts it into a song. And it's all about the incredible love of God. But Lord, as we hear this song, as we hear these words, as we prepare our hearts for communion, would you just allow us in this moment to feel something of the depth and height and length and breadth of your love? And God, we bring before you our failures right now. Even as we hear the song about your love, we're thinking of our own failures yesterday and today, our failures. And God, we bring those to you. We bring those to the throne of grace to receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We bring those to you, our merciful high priest. Speak to us about your love. Speak to us in Jesus' name. There was a line in there that got me last hour. I never thought of it this way, but something about when the Son of God died, he knew my name. He knew my name. Like, he didn't just die for everybody. He knew my name. That personalizes it for me. He knew my name when he died. And so his last act on this earth as a human being before he died was to take all the Old Testament shadows and show the disciples how they were being fulfilled in him. It was a Passover meal. They'd been celebrating that for 1,440 years since they came out of Egypt. It was a Passover, the Passover. Remember how the angel of death passed over the houses on which the blood of the lamb was on the doorposts? And in the houses of the Israelites, they were protected from death because the blood of the lamb was on the doorposts, the Passover. And Jesus says to the disciples, you know, you've been doing this for a century and a half, millennium and a half. And it all is a picture. It's a picture of the ultimate Passover, the blood of the lamb. The blood of the lamb that when put on the doorposts of your heart will cause the wrath of God to pass over so you can go to the promised land. They're probably scratching their heads during the meal like, what's he talking about? And they had four cups that were passed during the meal. They were all Passover cups that related to some aspect. They had unleavened bread that they'd break and eat, which like the unleavened bread the Israelites had to make when they hurried out of Egypt. And they had lamb. That lamb, one of those 200,000 lambs that were sacrificed for every group of 10, they had lamb for the meal. And they would dip the lamb in bitter herbs and spoke about the bitterness of bondage in Egypt. It all was symbolic. And at the end of the meal, Jesus basically looks at them and says, you know what? It's time for me now to introduce to you the new covenant. And he took one of the cups and he told them that it had new meaning. And he took some of the bread and he told them it had new meaning. And the bread he took, he says, I want you to share this bread with one another because it represents my body, which is about to be broken for you. So as often as you do this going forward, I want you to remember me. And they didn't understand because it was just after this. They went to the Garden of Gethsemane and Peter pulled out a sword and tried to protect Jesus from dying. They had no clue. They all ran for their lives. He denied you. They didn't understand. But they did it by faith. And later they understood that Jesus said, this body, this bread, it's my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's take the bread. A real human body, Jesus. Not some kind of a ghost or a shadow like the Gnostics said. Not some kind of a body that didn't leave footprints when he walked. Not some kind of a ghost that felt no pain on a cross. No. A real body broken for us. And then he took one of those four cups that were passed symbolically, probably the last one. He said, this cup, I want you to pass it around and drink it among yourselves because this represents the new covenant, my blood, which will be poured out to make the new covenant between God and man. And they didn't know what he was talking about. What new covenant? What new covenant? They didn't understand. But he said, drink the cup. It represents my blood. Someday you'll understand. But for now, drink the cup. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your body broken for us, for your blood poured out for us. We thank you. Nobody could think this up. It's too divine. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for being our great high priest who not only offered the sacrifice, but became the sacrifice. Thank you for being the priest and the lamb and the lover of our souls. We thank you. Amen. We're going to sing one more song just to celebrate the love of God. So let's stand up and worship together.
Oh, what love. What what hope we have that unfailing love of Jesus Christ.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
You know, it says in 1 John 3 that when we see him, we'll be like him. We'll see him just as he is. And when we get to heaven, there's going to be certain things that are answered and solved that we won't have to learn anymore about. But there's a reason that in the book of Revelation, when John saw heaven opened up, he saw Jesus as the Lamb that was slain. We are forever going to be learning about the love of God. I know that for a fact because it says it in Ephesians chapter 2. He raised us up with Christ, seated us with him in the heavenly places, in order that in the ages to come, he might show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. In the ages to come, that's what he's going to be teaching us. That's the only thing we're going to have to just keep exploring. In the ages to come, he'll show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness. That's why he's in heaven, the Lamb who was slain, because we're going to forever be learning about the depth of God's love and mercy and grace, because that is the whole deal when it comes to Christianity. It's the love of God. And so learn it now. You're going to be learning it forever. Learn it now. Enjoy it now. Live in it now. Lead with it when you talk to other people about your faith in Christ. Don't lead with law. Don't lead with rules. Don't lead with morality. Lead with the love of God, because that is the foundation of everything. And we're going to be learning about it forever. So Lord Jesus, teach us about it now. Help us to understand it more and more now, because in the ages to come, you're going to be reminding us and teaching us the surpassing riches of your grace and kindness. We're never going to fully comprehend the greatness of your love. Thank you. That's all we can say today is thank you. In your name, Jesus, amen.